do they happen?
Well, and how relationships change as you get more into the awakening process.
Well, it seems to me they actually occur.
Yes.
In some way.
Yeah. Well, it seems to be, you know, we meet with storylines. You know, I meet you, or I'm somebody, and I have a storyline about the last time I met this person. And so what happens then is that their storyline meets my storyline, their perception, their bag of perceptions around the neural network, which codes me into their consciousness, meets theirs. And so we never really come into contact, really, with each other. We're just going neural network to neural network.
Your story, get together with my story and work it
out. That's right, work it out. Yeah, you call my story. We'll schedule something.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
And so therefore, I mean, I've actually experienced this perceptually in the past that, you know, if I was having a kind of issue in what I thought was a relationship, that I would close my eyes and I would feel an extraordinary distance from that person. Like they were so far away, right? You know, this gets represented in pop songs, but I think it's based on a perceptual phenomenon that is actually correct, that we can be in physical proximity, but because we're actually mediated through symbolic frameworks that are accrued and not subject to our creative awareness, that in fact all that's really happening is our symbolic carapace is getting in contact with the other's symbolic carapace, and sometimes the symbolic carapaces love each other, and they say, "Ooh, your story meshes my story."
For a while,
yeah, Scorpio, Libra, right? You know, but inevitably, it's just then the stories. No story can really be made of that,
right?
You know, Aristotle noted that you know any good drama requires a conflict, and it's almost as if those stories, as kind of self-propagating machines, almost living things, they need conflict then in order to keep going as a story. Whereas if you are able to begin through daily ongoing practices with your story and just be with reality, then astonishingly enough, a lot, if not all of the conflict sort of disappears, right? And difference maybe emerges, right? There is difference present. Somebody sees, experiences something one way, another experiences something the other way, but it's not a problem if it doesn't fit in to the symbolic framework. So I always feel like the human gift of language and narrative is both our greatest gift and our greatest curse, because we begin to actually live in it instead of experiencing what reality has to manifest for us.
Well, as you touched on, too, that if you can be very still when the story of this person that you meet comes up, you can watch the story come up, you can watch expectations arise, and if you're fully present for that, then the story kind of starts to wither away, and we're guessing it's Hebbian, which is, you know, the neural networks say, well, is this important? Is this really useful, this image you have? And if you just don't take delivery on the package, then Hebbianly, you know, the connections start to wither away.
Darwin puts it in the trash.
Exactly. It's, you know, there is a, you know, neural Darwinism won a Nobel Prize. That idea of selecting out which ones are going to be survive or fail based upon how useful they were. And so from that standpoint, if you are very alert for emotions that arise, memories that arise, relationships, stories that arise, and just don't take delivery on the package, don't buy into the storyline and let go of it, then in fact that network will start to break down. And as it does, then you can, you know, you can see your relationship improve as you have less and less of that carapace that you talk about.
Yeah. And this can be true in personal relationships and also even the most superficial work relationships, which seem superficial because in some level they are, but they also actually have an enormous footprint in your life. So as you were speaking, a kind of image came to my mind that, you know, as you encounter someone from your work world or another aspect of your world that sort of feeds into any positive or negative pattern, any pattern whatsoever, that you imagine it's like you're receiving a special package, like you said, and you have to sign off on it. And you can say, oh, okay, so who's sending this feeling? Right. And it, to whom is it directed?
Right.
Okay. Well, return to non-existent sender.
there's no one here to get that
back. Sorry, nobody here by
nobody,
that.
Nobody here by
that. Lack of a name. No, I mean, because it's just in that pause that then the work takes place instead of the automatic, yeah, let's pick up where we last weren't.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
And then over time, you start to see that you actually, these beefs, these accrued grudges and, you know, ideas of past advantages or disadvantages begin to just disappear. You know, it's not as if the people disappear, but you encounter them just as people.
And as we've done with Nirvana Shatikam, working with it, you can look at all these things. You can pull them out and you can kind of probe, okay, well, how do I feel about Marcy? And you can just, when Marcy codes in, you can feel what comes along with that coding in of Marcy. And then you can just be present for that, be very empty for it. And but lo and behold, the thing starts to unravel, like a peeling onion. It begins to get weaker and weaker and weaker. You can take big pains in your life, big stresses, events you had, and they'll all unravel the same way.
And strangely enough, it can seem like, well, fine, you know, I can do that with sort of, you know, superficial instances in my life, but like not the big ones, you know, not when, you know, I think of, you know, grieving a lost loved one, for example. But in fact, in some kind of strange way, it's easier and more effective on the big ones because you get an immediate kind of positive feedback loop to it. If you, instead of saying, oh, how I miss him, right? You say to yourself, you know, there are feelings of grief present. Let me be with that grief. What is grief? What does grief feel like?
Right.
And there's a kind of beauty that the grief takes on, or the regret takes on.
Yeah.
Because you see grief or beauty, grief or regret, as grief or regret, i.e. as part of life. And they have a beautiful aspect to them, as opposed to, oh, I can't feel that. I can't deal with that.
Right. Well, as you were saying earlier, the whole, it appears that we get dopaminergically reinforced letting go. If you've got a big peak of emotion or some big story, and as you see, you go into it, and you can begin to work with it, just don't take the liver on the package, you actually feel good. You can feel the letting go taking place, and it could only be neurotransmitters. I mean, there's something is released to reinforce that letting go. Maybe the brain wants the real estate, whatever, but it feels good to go into those fears, go into those deep stresses and old pains, and invite them in, have them in for a cup of tea and be present with them and just see what happens. You may find it's not an awful thing. It may be a very sweet thing to let go of that story.
Yeah, I think it was, there's a Rumi story on this one, you know, the Sufi Persian poet. And he talks about the importance of just welcoming all emotions and feelings as guests.
Yes.
And you say, oh, yeah, come on in, come, you know, let's,
come,
you know.
Come down.
And rather than feeling like they need to repress and that they're parts of life that need to sort of go away and that life would be good if only they didn't exist. Instead, you can see the beauty of regret, that it has its own feeling tone, a feeling that it has its own beauty and that is part of a complete life.
Yeah. And each particular one. It's like very important to focus on each in particular instance.
That's right.
Because each instance has its own character and tone and feeling and mixture of fear and anger and hostility and love. And it's all bonded together. So you go into those, maybe coded through a person, a relationship, and you can feel, you know, as, you know, Marcy lets go, what's in that texture. You don't have to analyze it. Just recognize it. Don't take delivery on it. And it's surprising how freeing it is to open into that. People say, oh, I can't possibly face you saying that. that fear is just too horrible. I can't even think about, you know, losing Fred or something. But yet you go into that and you can say, well, there's great beauty to that. And you keep letting go. And it really is a beautiful process.
And as I think was very important that you just pointed out, each instance of it is totally unique.
Right.
So I think part of the fear, for example, with grief is that one is going to forget Fred, mm-hmm. for example.
Right.
But actually, by being with the feeling of loss or remorse or regret associated with that person, mm-hmm. you're actually doing the opposite than forgetting
right.
that
you're
person.
That. Yeah.
You're totally honoring Fred in his Fredness mm-hmm. and being with it, but in a way that allows you to integrate it rather than in a way that keeps you kind of in this endless cycle of forgetting and remembering.
Right.
And, what's beautiful, I think, about each one of these instances of just getting behind an emotion that one thought one had to keep away is that that actually allows the uniqueness mm-hmm. to come through. And when we feel uniqueness, that is the feeling of oneness,
right?
Right? That we see that there really is, was, could never be any other who was like Fred,
right?
And when we feel that oneness, that is the feeling of the oneness of the cosmos itself.
Absolutely.